Fixing the Star Wars Sequel Trilogy, Part 1. This is going to be a several-part series of TikToks. Force Awakens is only going to take one TikTok to fix because, quite frankly, I did enjoy it. I'm not going to change a thing about this crawl. I liked this crawl. This character played by Max von Sydow is going to be Master Rom Kota from The Force Unleashed. This gives at least some fans somebody to be connected with and breaks their heart when he dies. Next thing we're changing is everything BB-8 did, it's going to be replaced with R2-D2 because fuck BB-8 and all the merchandise he produced. Finally, the most important change we're making, because we're making a trilogy and we need a character that needs growth. In this scene, when Rey tries her third time to do the Jedi mind trick, the stormtrooper played by 007 is going to have a seizure or fall and hit his head on the release button to her restraints, not going to actually have the mind trick work. This gives her room to grow, but shows that she's powerful and doesn't know how to use her power. Fixing the Star Wars Sequel Trilogy, Episode 8. This first battle was cool. It gets to stay. Luke takes his lightsaber and his face is filled with questions, but instead of yeeting it behind him and hopefully killing a couple of porgs in the process, he's just going to hand the lightsaber back to Rey without a word, and when he sees the Millennium Falcon off of the cliff, he's going to turn around and say, "Where's Han Solo?" This scene between Kylo Ren and Snoke is going to be pretty much the same, except Kylo Ren is going to stutter and not be confident at all because there's a secret about the killing of Han Solo that Snoke does not know yet. For this scene, I had to come to a really difficult decision about real-life events and how they affected the filming of this movie. I'm so sorry, but I have to kill off General Leia in this scene. She's going to be replaced by Admiral Ackbar, not by Laura Dern. This guy's gonna feel the immediate loss of Leia right away, but there's someone very important who's not gonna feel it at all. Find out who in the next TikTok. Rey is going to feel the loss of General Leia immediately. It's going to feel like she's lost her mother, but she can't figure out why, but it doesn't take her long to figure out that. She's feeling what Ben Solo is feeling, because they do still have this connection that was established in the movie we got. He's gonna try to hide his pain, but he's still gonna express curiosity about this connection. Luke is hanging out in the Millennium Falcon, catching up with R2-D2 and Chewbacca. They're eating a roast porg. Luke is carrying on as if nothing has just happened, and Rey realizes then that he has cut himself off from the Force. After Rey breaks the news about Leia to Luke, he breaks out his lightsaber and agrees to teach her, as he's the only one left who can teach about the Force. Maz Kanata sends Finn and Poe on the Codebreaker mission. I'm going to keep the casino, but let's face it, it could have been done better, and it has been done better already. We're going to get this same thing with a Master Codebreaker they can't get to, but it's not going to be this guy. It's going to be this guy. Finn and Poe find Maz Kanata's old boyfriend, Lando Calrissian. Lando does nothing but smooth talk, both to Finn and Poe and to his opponents. We see him cheat, and so do his opponents, and a lighthearted chase ensues. It can have the same tone as this chase, but I think it should have been with speeders instead. Lando escapes alone on his YT-2000 freighter, which is a newer model of the Millennium Falcon, leaving Finn and Poe behind. As Finn and Poe get thrown into their cell, they talk openly about what's at stake. They are greeted by their cellmate who wakes up. It's not going to be this guy. It's going to be a woman who greets them by saying,
FN-2187.
And yes, that's going to be without the filter. For the most part, the Force connection scenes are going to be pretty much the same, but no matter is ever going to transfer between the two, because that is stupid. Rey's lessons with Luke about the Force are going to be exactly the same, because those were the best parts of this movie. When we get to this part of Rey's learning, this is not the vision we're going to get. We're going to get a vision of this level of destruction all over the galaxy, with Kylo Ren as the supreme leader, leading this destruction supremely. Luke gets nervous because while Rey was seeing that vision, he felt exactly what she was feeling, an ability in the Force that he's never seen before or read about. When she sees Ben again, he tells her about a vision he had had in that same place of Han and Leia in trouble, and how Luke had encouraged Ben to ignore it based on his own experiences with visions like that. This scene plays out just like we saw it, except Luke uses his green lightsaber and Rey uses his blue lightsaber. We'll dive deeper into this scene in part 5. Follow for that. Going back to this scene, we learn that while Ben was training and after he saw the vision of his parents in danger and Luke urged him not to act on it, he later found out that his parents actually had been in danger. This is what caused him to lash out and destroy Luke's academy. Just from watching this fight, we learn that Luke and Rey are pretty evenly matched. During this fight, Luke points out that using the dark side does offer a combative advantage, but at the cost of one's soul. As they continue to fight, Luke drops his green lightsaber. Rey takes a near-fatal swing with the blue lightsaber. Luke deflects it with his robotic hand, destroying it to the point of nearly being unrecognizable. Rey walks away, leaving Luke defeated in the rain, and he calls out, "Don't give in to hate. Trust in the Force." Rey leaves with Chewbacca and R2-D2. Finn, Poe, and Phasma successfully get onto the Star Destroyer that is pursuing the Resistance, using a plan that one of Finn's old friends told him about. Finn even gives Phasma a blaster to help them get through. When Poe goes to start disabling the tracker, Phasma turns her blaster on both of them. Finn tells Poe to keep working. Phasma tries to fire her blaster, but it is empty. Phasma grabs a piece of pipe, Finn grabs a stun baton from his stormtrooper belt, and we get this fight. When Poe says he's almost done, Phasma taunts Finn with the fact that she trained him in this style of combat, something that she emphasizes by cutting off Finn's arm. Just as she's about to deal a killing blow, Poe does this to Phasma. Poe helps Finn into an escape pod, leaving a trail of blood. Stormtroopers are firing at the door by the time it closes. I cannot wait to show you what happens in that escape pod. Follow for more. Rey, Chewie, and R2 arrive at the Resistance to see that they're still being pursued by Snoke's ship. After telling Chewbacca that Luke is useless, Rey reaches out to the Force to see if Kylo Ren is on the ship, and she finds out that he is. After she leaves, Chewbacca and R2-D2 have a brief argument. Luke is sitting on a cliff, meditating and mumbling about how he failed both Ben and Rey. He hears a whiny but echoey voice behind him telling him that he didn't fail. He turns around. Luke tells all of his failures to his father, Anakin Skywalker. Anakin tells Luke about how there's darkness in everybody and it's not right to hide it. Luke hears a woman's voice calling his name from the other direction. He turns around and we get the reunion scene that was filmed. In a shot where we don't see Leia's face, but we see Luke reacting, we get an impersonator, because there's plenty out there, to say, "Failure is not the end." Follow for part 8. Finn and Poe launch their escape pod. Right after they launch, they're going to get a warning that says there's a target lock. To break the target lock, Poe shuts down the engines and all utilities. The injured Finn does call him crazy for doing this as they start to burn through the atmosphere. Poe gets real with Finn and says we're probably not going to make it. Poe extends emergency wings on the escape pod to bring it to a glide, but he cannot shed any of the immense amounts of speed that he's gathered. As they're about to hit the surface of Crait and they're bracing themselves for death, Finn pushes his hand downward and they kind of bounce off of the surface like a skipping rock. Then they come to a crack. The crash is going to look kind of like this one, but somehow they do survive. Poe laughs with glee, Finn laughs with him too, and then remembers that he is still very severely injured. Follow this page for part 9. Rey and Kylo Ren face Snoke, who basks in the glow of the dark side coming from them both. Snoke monologues about the power of the dark side, how it can be used for both good and evil in the universe. He tells Rey the same stories of Darth Vader that he told Ben, but Rey adds the ending where Vader turned against the Emperor to save his son, which triggers a reaction in Kylo Ren, as a blocked memory comes back to him. Kylo Ren accuses Snoke of manipulating his memories, to which Snoke openly admits. Kylo Ren attacks Snoke and Rey quickly joins in. The guards step in to protect Snoke, and this was probably one of the best scenes of the movie, so we're keeping this exactly as is. They win the fight, Snoke laughs, and they turn their attention back to Snoke. Follow for part 10. Rey and Finn both stand before Snoke. Snoke follows the tradition of Sith Masters.
"Finish it. Strike me down and unleash your full potential on the dark side of the Force. I can see it in you. Your destiny has always been to be the most powerful Sith of all time. I see your mind, too. I see the moment he died. Yes, your father ignited your lightsaber. You're weak, you're pathetic. But I feel your loyalty. I see you standing at the side of the Supreme Leader and..." "Of course."
Stay tuned on this channel for part 11. Ben asks Rey what happened back there. She says that she knows he will be at her side at the end, and that Snoke could feel that coming from her, not from Ben. When they get out of the elevator, they are stopped by General Hux. Rey reacts quickly and manipulates his emotions to make him loyal to both of them as if they were both the Supreme Leader. Back on Luke's planet with Luke alone and fucking alive, this scene happens just like it did in Rise of Skywalker with the same music cue and everything. As Resistance transports start to take off for the surface of Crait, Admiral Ackbar comes over a hologram to give a briefing.
The codes to open the shield doors are being transmitted to you now. Make haste, but be ready for evasive action. May the Force be with us all.
Staying behind to draw fire and give the shuttles a fighting chance, Admiral Ackbar fires at the Star Destroyer. The last transport gets out just in time, with C-3PO on the last transport to witness the explosion. For the setup of the first battle and for the first moments of it, I'm really not going to change anything because this looked fucking cool. Although Finn's not going to be in this fight because he's injured and, like a good boyfriend, Poe said no. There's only going to be four walkers here, but that's still plenty to make those speeders pretty helpless and useless. On board that shuttle with Rey, Ben, and General Hux, they get a signal saying that there are two ships approaching very fast. Ben whispers that it's the Falcon. Inside the Resistance base, we hear an older member of the Resistance say, "Is that Red 5?" With Luke's X-Wing flying directly below the Millennium Falcon, they make a fast approach toward the side of the first walker. We don't get a lot of time to celebrate, though, because Luke's X-Wing crashes directly into the side of one of the walkers, dominoing onto the second walker, leaving only two left. Inside the base, there's silence, except for the firing of TIE fighter cannons outside at the Millennium Falcon. With Rey, Ben, and the entire Resistance being faked out, which is obvious to us, about the death of Luke Skywalker, the Falcon goes into those caverns and loses those TIE fighters with the same awesome music cue. The Falcon comes out and fires a tow cable at the walkers, wrapping both of the remaining walkers up and tripping them. As we watch Rey and Ben deduce who is in the gunner's seat, the Falcon lands in front of the Resistance base. Luke Skywalker steps out in person and still old as shit and draws his green lightsaber. General Hux offers to fire, but Ben decides he needs to land and take care of this personally. While the shuttle is landing, R2-D2 makes his way into the Resistance base, but Chewbacca stays on the Falcon. Ben and Rey step out to confront Luke. Ben angrily says that it is time for the Jedi to die. Luke responds with, "You're right." Luke apologizes to Ben for telling him to bottle up the darkness inside him. Ben tries to hide the fact that this is taking him off guard. Luke tells Ben that the Jedi and the Sith are both wrong to tell their students to shut away parts of who they are. He tells Ben about when Anakin Skywalker saved his life by embracing both parts of himself. Luke offers to continue training Ben with this new viewpoint on the Force. Ben turns off his lightsaber and chokes up as he says, "Uncle Luke." The moment Ben turns off his lightsaber, Rey turns on the blue lightsaber that Luke used to own and shouts out that Luke is a liar. Rey stabs Luke through the chest, causing Kylo Ren to shout, "No!" Ben uses the Force to push Rey away and she drops the lightsaber. Ben drags his injured uncle onto the Millennium Falcon and Force pulls the blue lightsaber toward him as the door closes. Chewbacca takes the Millennium Falcon off the planet and into space. The cannons at the base aim at the shuttle. Rey gets on and they leave. Ben tends to his uncle in this exact same spot of the Millennium Falcon. As soon as they are safe, Chewbacca comes in. Ben offers the blue lightsaber back to Luke, but Luke rejects it, offering it as a family heirloom. Luke dies from his injuries and vanishes, leaving his clothes behind, as well as his damaged robot hand and his green lightsaber. Chewbacca screams loudly and falls to where Luke's feet just were. Ben puts his hand on the remaining robotic hand and the green lightsaber and calls out for Rey. He doesn't get an answer. Rey, now dressed in black, stands at the bridge of a Star Destroyer with General Hux at her side, telling him that they have work to do. Finn looks up at the stars from Crait. Poe approaches him and says, "I'll help you find Rey." Finn responds with, "No, I know where I'm needed, and it's not with the Resistance." They both make eye contact and Poe says, "I know." They both look up at the stars and... Following the opening crawl, we tilt down to see Mustafar. From behind us, a First Order shuttle approaches the planet. This shuttle lands at the abandoned castle that once belonged to Darth Vader. Rey steps off of the shuttle and turns on this lightsaber that we saw in the real movie. She is followed by a squad of stormtroopers. With minimal help from her stormtroopers, Rey cuts down a band of raiders, who themselves are trying to get into Darth Vader's castle. As Rey enters, she sees visions of Sith spirits past, including Revan, Nihilus, Maul, Dooku, Snoke, and Palpatine. As we hear whispers of Sith teachings they all learned and taught, the rest of the spirits converge into Palpatine. Palpatine explains that as the teachings of the Sith pass down through generations, the spirits of the Sith live on in the learners. He tells Rey that this has been her destiny since before she was born. On Coruscant, General Hux is addressing the entire planet through giant holograms, declaring that this planet is now under the authority of the First Order. A sense of hopelessness looms over the planet as stormtroopers occupy the streets. Wanted holograms of Poe Dameron and other resistance leaders are shining, and resistance fighters are taken off the streets by stormtroopers. We go into the Outlander nightclub from Attack of the Clone. Over at the Pazok table, there is a huge pile building among several players, a pile of credits and trinkets. Several players of different alien races fold, and it boils down to two players. Finn stares down his opponent and asks if this pod is big enough to get passage to the Outer Rim. His opponent responds,
"Not quite, my friend. You will have to make it a little more interesting."
Finn takes off his robotic arm and puts it on the pile. This hand of Pazok continues, and Hondo backs Finn into a draw or lose scenario.
"Not to worry, my friend. You take back your arm, I take you to, let's say, Malastair."
But as players of Knights of the Old Republic know, and as will be established here, Finn pulls out an extremely rare tiebreaker card. Hondo panics for a moment, and he even brings the tiebreaker card to a dealer, who verifies that this is a legit tiebreaker card. He turns back to Finn and says,
"Where to, my friend?"
Finn puts his robotic arm back on and says, "The First Order shipyard at Raxus Prime, do you know it?" As Finn and Hondo make their way out, Finn turns to the bartender, offers him the tiebreaker card, and says, "You never saw either of us." The Millennium Falcon flies through space, and we see that Chewbacca is in the pilot seat. In the common area, we see Ben meditating. He repeats Rey's name in quietly desperate calls. After a minute of this, he gives up for the moment. He calls for his mother, with no answer. Then he calls for his grandfather like he used to, and repeats his pull to the light monologue, but as a pull to the dark. The lights go out. Ben leaps to his feet and turns on his lightsaber to see who's standing behind him. Darth Vader is silent for a moment, but then he takes off his helmet. Anakin looks around and admires the ship, pointing out that he can smell a coolant leak and suggesting that Tabana gas is the best coolant to use. Ben tells Anakin that he can't go back to the First Order or to the Resistance. Anakin tells him to trust his feelings. Ben runs into the cockpit and asks Uncle Chewie if he knows where to find any Tabana gas. In the underworld that is Nar Shaddaa, we see the First Order struggling to maintain order despite giant holograms reminding the public that helping the Resistance is treason. In a dark alleyway, R2-D2 is hacking a terminal and Poe Dameron is rehearsing the message of hope for the people. As Poe's broadcast goes out to Nar Shaddaa, the people get more violent against the First Order. We see a squad of stormtroopers run past a row of wanted holograms for Poe Dameron. One of the stormtroopers stops to look at a hologram that looks a little bit off. The hologram punches the stormtrooper and Poe Dameron makes his escape. Poe and R2-D2 make their way through the crowd, the regular people letting them through with no problem and blocking the First Order. With the underworld scum protecting them, Poe and R2-D2 get into Poe's X-Wing and head up into space toward the blockade of Star Destroyers. Poe flies between two Star Destroyers above Nar Shaddaa and gets them to fire on each other exactly right so that they destroy each other. Back at Coruscant, yet another Star Destroyer comes out of hyperspace above the planet. Rey is about to take a shuttle down to Coruscant, but she sees an old freighter passing by the hangar. Two TIE fighters fly right past Rey out of the hangar to deal with this broken down freighter. On board the freighter, Hondo is trying to sweet talk his way out of it while Finn looks off to the side toward the hangar. We see that Rey senses Finn on board the freighter, and she twitches her fingers, and one of the TIE fighters fires at the other, and then she crashes the remaining TIE fighter into the Star Destroyer. Finn and Hondo make their escape, and Rey makes her way down to the surface of Coruscant. Ben and Chewbacca make their approach to Bespin and land on a landing platform. At the same time, Rey makes her approach to the Jedi Temple on Coruscant, which is long since abandoned. We get a Force Connection conversation between Rey and Ben, with clever editing to make it look like they're walking in opposite directions. Ben tells Rey about the darkness he can feel coming from her, but she tries to ignore him. Once Ben gets just a little too annoying, Rey stops and says he was supposed to be at her side at the end. Ben reminds her that the end isn't there yet. Ben continues in the same direction to the mining facility, while the camera follows Rey from the other side now into the Jedi Temple. Poe Dameron goes to Tatooine, this time with C-3PO at his side. Surrounded by shady aliens and humans, Poe expresses relief that the First Order is nowhere to be found. Yet. And he does show that he feels right at home here. Over at the view screens in this cantina, Poe hears a hut cursing in Huttese. He recognizes the word racer, so he approaches this hut, asking what's wrong with this racer. Using C-3PO as a translator, the hut tells Poe that his racer has just been killed in the race going on right now. Poe offers to race in exchange for a meeting with the King of the Hutts. The hut laughs and agrees to Poe's offer. Poe asks, "Great, where can I find a good racing pod?" Having been trying to interrupt this conversation for a minute, C-3PO explains that this hemisphere observes swoop racing, not pod racing. Poe asks what swoop racing is. Finn and Hondo arrive on Raxus Prime, where the First Order sends its workers for disciplinary reasons, building new ships out of the mountains of scrap on this planet. Finn wears an oxygen mask to protect him from the poisonous atmosphere, which does not harm Hondo. They arrive at a factory and start looking for a ship to steal. Hondo finds a well-guarded gunship, but Finn finds a poorly guarded AT-AT carrier. They both point out weak points in the structure. Finn pulls out a bag of explosives. Hondo asks, "Do you have any experience with those?" Which we all know he does. Rey restores power to the Jedi Archives and begins searching for something. While she does her search, a mysterious hooded figure appears to watch her. Ben and Chewbacca sit down to an empty dinner table that we have seen before. This would be a good point for Ben to tell Uncle Chewie, "I have a bad feeling about this." Maz Kanata comes into the room and greets Chewbacca excitedly, telling him that she wants to see him alone later. Without having him introduce himself, she asks Little Solo where he got that lightsaber on his hip. All he manages to get out is the words, "My Uncle Luke," when she interrupts, "Luke Skywalker is dead, isn't he?" She tells Ben about the time a lightsaber ignited inside her coolant line and how she had settled with Lando Calrissian, with him taking the broken ship and her taking this facility, thus explaining how she came into possession of Luke Skywalker's lightsaber. Poe brings his swoop bike to the starting line. C-3PO gets really annoying about the odds of surviving a swoop race, to which Poe Dameron actually turns to him and just says, "3PO, shut up!" Poe makes some impossible dodges but manages to set a track record. As Poe gets to the finish line, he has this moment. He does a donut, leaving a trail of dust, and coming out of the cloud of dust are four stormtroopers on speeder bikes. He runs the course in reverse, getting all four speeders to crash. As spectators try to surround Poe to celebrate what they just saw, he picks up C-3PO and sprints into a cargo truck. The cargo truck disappears in a convoy toward a Hutt palace. The few guards that are guarding this carrier are no problem for Hondo Ohnaka. Hondo uses a fun combination of ancient Weequay techniques and advanced technology-related techniques to take down the guard. As Hondo's about to get onto the carrier, Finn comes running like this, telling Hondo to start the engine, screaming it at the top of his lungs. Hondo snipes a couple of the troopers chasing Finn, but he keeps saying, "Start the engines, start the engines." Once Finn is inside the carrier, Hondo takes off and Finn tells him to go faster. They just barely escape in time to avoid being eaten up by a coaxium explosion. Once they're off the planet, Finn explains that he didn't know there was coaxium there until after he planted the explosives. They hear a rumbling from below them. They open the hatch into the walker below and find about half a dozen First Order cadets. Rey searches at a computer station at the Jedi Archives. She scrolls through some planets and then goes back to one that stands out to her. As she looks at artwork of what may or may not exist there, as this is all legend, the hooded figure whispers,
"I don't know what you want, but if you're looking for the Sith Temple on Korriban, I cannot let you leave here alive."
Finally acknowledging that this person is a threat, Rey turns on her lightsaber, and so does the hooded figure. Poe Dameron leads a convoy of ships to the derelict but crowded Resistance base on Dantooine. There, he makes a speech about how being few in numbers is not reason to give up, and that the galaxy is ready for a fight. This speech is broadcast across the galaxy. Poe says it's only a matter of which side everybody chooses to fight for. In hyperspace, on the Walker carrier, Finn and Hondo interrogate these cadets about why they didn't attack. One by one, they take off their helmets and tell Finn that they know who he is and they want to join his fight. One of the cadets tells Finn that they are being tracked. Finn takes Hondo into the cockpit and asks if he's ever heard of the Dameron maneuver. When Hondo says no, Finn smiles as he's about to teach him. Ben is trying to get some sleep when he hears his name being called from what sounds like his Uncle Luke. As Ben wanders the halls of Cloud City, he feels the echoes of the duel that his Uncle Luke and Darth Vader had here. As Ben looks out the broken window, Anakin tells him that he was trying to wear Luke down, and that Luke made it very easy because his mind was divided and unfocused. Ben jumps down onto the platform where Anakin is already waiting for him. Anakin tells him that Luke came closer than he would ever admit to turning to the dark side that day. Rey stands across a library aisle from Mace Windu, who keeps the stump where his right hand used to be tucked under his robes. He reminds her that she is on holy ground and that no matter how she tries, the Jedi have the advantage in here. Rey swings her lightsaber at Mace, and even though his lightsaber is turned on, he doesn't deflect. He dodges every one of her swings. When one of Rey's swings singes Mace Windu's long white beard, he starts to advance on her, deflecting everything she's doing with his lightsaber now. It becomes very clear that he's too powerful for her, which she recognizes right away and makes her retreat. As she exits the Jedi Temple, she sends stormtroopers inside to kill the Jedi. As she gets on the shuttle and leaves her troopers behind, Rey sees a vision of Cloud City and sees Ben there. She orders his immediate arrest. Finn and Hondo bring their ship around in a donut maneuver like this. Facing the direction they just came from, they wait for a tense moment. What would be the eyes of the AT-AT turn on in a red line. The AT-AT fires its cannons at the Star Destroyer. Hondo has trouble compensating for the recoil from these shots. The cadets manage to turn the head in the right direction to hit a power sphere on the Star Destroyer, and they jump into hyperspace, leaving it behind to explode. As the cadets open up the hatch to come up into the carrier, an emergency broadcast happens. Rey makes an announcement to the entire First Order to bring all ships and enforcements to Korriban. Hondo tries to convince Finn to run. Finn convinces Hondo that the Resistance is the safest place for them, so they plot a course to Dantooine. Poe is giving a briefing about the different strengths and weaknesses of each of the different types of ships they'll be facing. This briefing is cut short as a Walker carrier ship lands nearby and the Resistance starts to draw their weapons on it. Finn is the first one to step down off of the carrier. Poe tells the Resistance to stand down. The two hug for a lingering moment. As Hondo climbs down, Poe pulls a gun on him. Hondo laughs as he puts his hand up. They suggest a vague history that leads to Hondo currently owing Poe a favor. This is when we learn that Poe used to be a spice runner before he joined the Resistance, and that he saved Hondo Onaka's ass many, many times. Ben stares over the edge of the platform at Cloud City, finishing his lesson with Anakin. He calls Anakin Lord Vader, causing Anakin to shake his head. As we hear stormtroopers approaching, Anakin reminds Ben that he was born Anakin Skywalker and he died Anakin Skywalker. The troopers surround Ben, cornering him in the exact same spot where Vader cornered Luke. We hear Anakin whisper, "Trust only in the Force." The troopers call for him, saying, "Ben Solo, you're under arrest." But he corrects them and says his name is Ben Skywalker. Ben jumps from the platform and lands in the same tube Luke landed in. It opens up. Ben tumbles clumsily off the weather vane and lands on the roof of the Millennium Falcon. When he gets in, he finds Chewbacca piloting and Maz Kanata co-piloting. Maz Kanata shows a hologram. Poe is giving an impassioned speech about meeting at Korriban for the final battle to fight for the side you support. Rey meditates in a dark room on board her Star Destroyer. Emperor Palpatine addresses her.
"The power to vanquish your enemies is one we who live within you have all aspired to. Our knowledge fills your mind. In the temple lies the only one who discovered the deepest secrets. He who refused to share them with me, my master. Find him. Take what was once his, and you will be unstoppable."
The Resistance gears up for the final battle. Poe puts Finn in charge of this walker. He asks if there's a call sign for it. Without hesitation, Finn says, "It's called the Organa." Rey enters the Sith Temple, and it doesn't take long for her to find the tomb she's looking for. Rey opens the tomb and finds the mummy of Darth Plagueis the Wise, holding two lightsabers in his hands. She steals both of them from him. She turns toward the camera. There is a swell of dramatic music as we see that Rey's eyes have turned yellow and red, showing that she has fully turned to the dark side. Rey steps out of the temple to find that there is already a space battle going on above the planet. Hondo reminds Poe that if he gets hit even once, he's going to bail. As Hondo makes his way down toward the planet, it does not take long for three TIE fighters to end up on his tail. Hondo panics and goes toward the release button for the walker, but as he's about to press it, the TIE fighters get hit from above. We see that the TIE fighters got hit by the Millennium Falcon and we hear a familiar noise. After that, we get a long and epic GoPro shot from the carrier as it flies down toward the planet, including seeing an X-Wing destroy a TIE fighter efficiently, a Y-Wing bombing a Star Destroyer, an A-Wing maneuvering out of its own missile lock, and a B-Wing's powerful laser beam cutting through several TIEs at once. Rey smiles as the AT-AT carrier approaches its landing site, but knows immediately what's going on when it faces a line of walkers instead of lining up alongside them. Rey holds the ship in place with the Force. Hondo drops the walker and it makes a harder landing than intended. Hondo tries to get his ship away and everything breaks down around him, sparks flying everywhere. Hondo sighs.
"I always knew the Jedi would be the death of me."
Rey destroys the carrier with Force lightning, killing Hondo. Against the backdrop of flaming pieces of the ship and Hondo raining down, Rey climbs up the walker. Rey cuts a hole in the walker, turns on the lightsabers of Darth Plagueis, and one by one, cuts down all of the cadets inside the walker. Reacting to Rey breaching the cockpit before it happens, Finn points a blaster so that her face is within inches of it when she enters. Without hesitation, she responds by holding a lightsaber to his head. With a little more hesitation, she demands that he get out before she has to kill him. Finn tells her to go ahead if that's what she's ready to do. In a tense moment of will she or won't she, louder blasters and explosions are heard outside. The Millennium Falcon has led a mixed set of ships to the surface, including multiple personnel carriers. Rey uses the Force to knock out Finn and aims the Organa's cannons at the Falcon, which is too fast for her to hit. She steps out on top of the walker with both of the lightsabers in her hands. Ben steps out of the Millennium Falcon with both of Luke's lightsabers in his hands, and the Falcon takes off to rejoin the battle. Rey jumps off and the two meet between the legs of the walker. Rey explains that Korriban fuels the dark side and that Ben has no chance here. Ben responds with what he has learned, which is that the most powerful users of the Force use both sides in balance, a technique that Anakin Skywalker had once perfected before abandoning the light. Ben demonstrates this by effortlessly pulling one of the Star Destroyers out of space and making it crash on the horizon. Rey lunges at Ben and they begin the fight to end all fights. Ben acts mostly on the defensive, having to put more effort into it than Vader did for Luke on Bespin, but successfully getting Rey to attack with all of her might. Finn wakes up and puts the Organa into motion, starting off with destroying the Sith Temple. Rey and Ben continue fighting with four lightsabers between the two of them, now dodging the moving feet of the Organa. Ben pushes Rey into the path of one of the walker's feet. She dodges it, but her cloak gets caught underneath it, forcing her to roll out of it. The Organa starts taking fire from both walkers and TIE fighters. Rey attacks Ben with the same ferocity he used against her in The Force Awakens, and she's clearly getting tired from this fight. Ben reminds her that relying exclusively on the dark side comes at a cost to your body and soul. He also says that relying exclusively on the light comes at a cost of awareness in the moment. Through the shower of sparks coming from where the walker is getting hit, Ben urges Rey to look around. He points out all of this unnecessary and avoidable death, stating that neither the light side nor the dark is worth all of this. The shields fail on the walker. Finn whispers for Rey, and then as the walker explodes, he shouts out for Poe. Rey and Ben narrowly avoid the crashing wreckage of the exploded walker. Rey reaches out toward the walkers that made this happen and tries to tip them over. She fails. Ben reaches his hand out and does it with no effort. In a fury, Rey reaches upward with Force Lightning, downing mostly TIE fighters, but also a few Resistance ships. As Rey tries to make a retreat, thinking that this is too much, Ben reassures her that she can find that balance. While repeating something like, "Feel the light and the dark," both of them bring down the entire fleet. General Hux hopelessly shouts out orders as his Star Destroyer goes down with all of the rest. Rey rushes to the wreckage of the walker and only finds Poe Dameron's jacket. A personnel carrier lands, and Rey and Ben are both arrested by the Resistance. Rey and Ben are locked in separate holding cells. Both of them are meditating, but the ship stops, pulling them out of their concentration. Poe comes in to let them both know that they'll be on Coruscant soon to face the Senate for the crimes they've committed against the New Republic. Rey tries to use the mind trick to get Poe to open the door. He chuckles. Ben uses the Force to make Poe dizzy, and Rey does the mind trick again and gets him to open the door. Rey and Ben retrieve their collection of lightsabers and sneak their way over to the escape pods. The ship goes on red alert, but they make it to an escape pod with minimal damage to the ship. The Resistance flagship fires at the escape pod, but to no avail. Poe watches a view screen, and the escape pod, according to his readings, explodes on impact with the planet. Back on Coruscant, the giant holograms are now Poe Dameron giving a eulogy for all of the fallen soldiers of this war. After Poe finishes his eulogy, Mace Windu steps up and leads the galaxy in a prayer. "The Force is with me, and I am one with the Force." The entire galaxy chants it in their native languages. We do see Chewbacca and Maz Kanata together, as well as a reunited C-3PO and R2-D2, but this would also be a great chance to include some Legends and Extended Universe characters. At the partially buried homestead of Owen and Beru Lars, Rey and Ben look at the twin sons. Accepting that they are all that's left of the Jedi and the Sith, Rey concludes the trilogy by stating that as long as they live, the Force does too, and they will draw students of a new order to the path that they should take.